WF House presents an unabridged recording of Evergreens by Liam Brown, narrated by Harrie Dobby and Dan Bottomley. 2070. 1. It's not always easy to spot the humans these days. Take the nurses. Sophie has been sitting in the intensive care unit for 5 hours, and she's still struggling to distinguish between the real ones and the fakes. Several times she's been mid-conversation with a young man or woman in pale blue scrubs, only to discover her mistake, an unfamiliar combination of words triggering a glitch in their system, their expression freezing as they lock into a disconcerting mantra. "Please let me know how I can be of further assistance. Please let me know how I can be of further assistance." She feels like an old fool, but it's an easy mistake to make. The technology is so advanced that, other than a slight deadness in their eyes and a tendency to occasionally drift through the walls, it's almost impossible to tell these holographic virtual assistants from their flesh and blood counterparts. Not that there's many of those left. Almost everything, from taking bloods to performing physical examinations, has been automated for years now. Even the beds make themselves. The receptionists, pharmacists, and bereavement counsellors have all gone too, outsourced to an army of beaming algorithms. Sophie gets it, of course. Holograms never get sick or tired or depressed, never complain about unsociable hours or unsafe working conditions. There's no pension plan or holiday entitlement to worry about. They make perfect business sense. Even so, she doesn't like them. Maybe she's just old-fashioned, but she finds their presence unsettling, offensive even, especially on a ward filled with people who are barely hanging on to life. There are more than enough ghosts around here without adding any more. Besides, it's not like they're any good at answering her questions, although perhaps that's not entirely their fault. And it's not as if the handful of human medics she's encountered have been any more helpful. Why is this happening? Is he dying? Human or hologram, all she ever gets is a glazed expression and a static smile. Nobody knows what's wrong with Ben. All they know is he won't wake up. She turns her attention back to the handsome young man lying in the bed. There's not a mark on his face. He looks so peaceful he could almost be sleeping, apart from the machines, of course. And the machines are difficult to ignore. They rasp and whir, hiss and purr. And then there's the persistent chirrup of the heart monitor, a baby bird begging for a worm. "Feed me, feed me, feed me or I'll die." Once again, she finds herself resisting the urge to tear him from the tangle of tubes that snake from under his bedsheets, to free him from the high-tech devices that are doing things so complex she can scarcely believe they are real. Hydrating, draining, pumping, sucking. Everything, in other words, that needs to happen in order for him to stay alive. If you can call this a life. Hanging from the gaping neck of the man's hospital robe is a small chain, a silver pinecone pendant glistening in the antiseptic light. She reaches across and tucks it back under his gown, then finds his hand. It's reassuringly warm. She squeezes it, stares at it. Aside from the plastic cannula taped to the back of it, it looks the same as it always has. Neatly trimmed nails, the back of it smooth and hairless, only the faintest of lines intersecting his palm. A boy's hand. She slides her fingers between his, interlacing, interlocking, as if playing a game. Here's the church, and here's the steeple. Compared to his hands, her own are a horror show. Smeared with age spots and snagged with bulbous blue veins, the skin sagging and bunched, seeming to slip away from her bones altogether in places, as if she's trying to escape herself, as if she's disappearing. She squeezes again, this hand she's held so many times across the decades. And as she squeezes, she is gripped by a sudden anger that it is him in the bed and her at his side, and not the other way around. This is not how it was supposed to be. She keeps squeezing, her nails biting into his tender flesh until the capillaries burst and a thin stream of red trickles down his wrist. Wake up, Ben. Wake up. But still he doesn't respond. She hears someone behind her, a woman in a white coat, a silver stethoscope wrung around her neck, a paper-thin tablet computer in her hand. She's young, pretty too. Sophie has reached the age where she finds all young people pretty, their youth a prettiness in itself. But this doctor is disarmingly beautiful, her features free from the telltale signs of stem cell fillers or nanobot implants or anything else. She's all natural, this one. Or is she? Sophie stares into the doctor's dazzling green eyes, scanning for errant pixels. Are you real? She asks. The doctor looks amused. Sadly, very much so. I've got the blisters on my feet to prove it. Sophie nods. Well, that's something. Is there any news? The doctor glances down at her notes, frowns. We're still waiting on some test results, Mrs. Walker, but I promise we're doing everything we can for your grandson. Sophie looks at her blankly, confused for a moment, and then she remembers. Oh, no, you've got it wrong. He's not my grandson. He's my husband. If the doctor is shocked by the difference in their physical appearance, she doesn't show it. There's a flicker of something, a slight fluttering of her lashes, but then her eyes are back on the screen. Well, as I say, we're waiting on some results from the lab. Once we get those back, we should hopefully have a clearer picture of what's going on. In the meantime, you should go home and get some rest. I assure you, Ben's in the best possible hands. And then she is heading off on her rounds, while Sophie once again takes up her lonely bedside vigil. Wake up, Ben. Wake up. After a while, she falls asleep in the chair. Recently, this has been happening more and more, at home, at her family's house, at the theatre. She doesn't even feel it happening. One minute she's fully conscious, the next she's waking up with a stiff neck and drool on her chin. Just another indignity of old age to add to the list, she supposes. When she opens her eyes again, she finds an entire hour has passed. She sits up sheepishly and wipes her face, for once glad of the dearth of human staff on the ward. She glances at Ben and sees that he hasn't moved. She shakes her head. Maybe the doctor was right about her going home. She could freshen up, grab a change of clothes, feed the dog. She hauls herself to her feet and leans over him. I'll be back soon, she promises. She stoops to place a kiss on his cheek. However, she stops. Something has caught her eye. Buried in his thick mane of dark hair, there is something new, something she's never seen before, at least not on Ben. A solitary silver hair stands out among all the others. How curious, she thinks, as she peers closer to examine it. And then something even stranger happens. As she watches, another hair begins to change colour. Starting at the tip and then moving to the root, it turns from brown to grey to white, and then another, and another. Sophie takes off her glasses and polishes them against her blouse, cursing her failing vision. But when she looks again, the effect is even more pronounced. Dozens of hairs have changed, then hundreds. As impossible as it seems, Ben's hair is turning white before her eyes. 2005. 1. Inside the pub, the noise is punishing, pummeling, a ceaseless squall of guitar and drums that fills every square centimetre of the venue. The Espy is an enormous white Victorian building, which in its heyday must have been one of the grandest hotels in town. Today, it's a sticky-floored dive bar with live music spread across three floors, making it impossible to escape the ear-splitting clatter of local bands. Usually it's a fun night out, but not tonight. At least, not for Sophie. She is perched at the bar with her back to the band, the dregs of some exotic cocktail sitting in front of her. Beside her, her friends Samantha and Mag stare sullenly at their own drinks. Nobody is talking. The three school friends have spent the last 7 months travelling, a non-stop gap-year adventure to celebrate finishing sixth form. They've ridden rickshaws in Rajasthan and tuk-tuks in Thailand. They've visited the beaches of Boracay, the killing fields of Cambodia, and the gleaming space-age towers of Kuala Lumpur. It has been, without a doubt, the best year of Sophie's life. Yet it is Australia she has enjoyed the most, particularly St Kilda, the beachside suburb of Melbourne they've called home for the last 4 weeks. Or rather, she's enjoyed it up until now. The trouble had begun earlier on the beach. Mags had bumped into a group of English boys and arranged for the three of them to meet up with them later that night. Sophie had been unenthusiastic, especially when Mags had pointed them out to her. Even from a distance, she could tell they were a dead loss. Two of them were Mags's usual type, hulking, muscle-bound posers, one with a shaved head, the other a bleached mohawk. The third, meanwhile, was even less promising. A tall, pale strip of a thing, his red board shorts hanging off his skinny body. Not her type at all. Sophie had tried to wriggle out of it, feigning tiredness, but in the end, she'd allowed herself to be dragged along to the pub in order to keep the numbers even. Only so far, the boys haven't shown. As the hours have ticked by, the girls have grown impatient and snappy with each other, a situation that has not been helped by the copious amounts of alcohol they've all downed while waiting. Mags, in particular, appears to have decided to get as drunk as possible, ordering tequila shots to accompany each of the tooth-shredding cocktails. Sophie is about to announce to the girls that she is calling it a night, when a boisterous yell from the other side of the room announces the boys' arrival. They amble up to them, full of apologies, excuses, and, from the smell of them, beer. After a swift round of introductions, it quickly becomes apparent that conversation isn't the boys' strong suit. Not that it's really possible to talk over the jagged screech and clatter blasting from the nearest stage. Paul, who Sophie quickly pegs as their ringleader, seems exclusively focused on getting everyone even drunker than they already are, ordering round after round of Jaeger bombs for the table. Each time he orders, he makes an elaborate show of paying with a crumpled wad of dollars he pulls from his cargo shorts. When he speaks, it's only to fire cringeworthy one-liners in Samantha's direction, most of which are met with howls of laughter from Darren, a hyperactive man-child, whose sole contribution to the group is to leap up and flail around arrhythmically each time the band plays a song he half recognizes, while simultaneously trying to drag the girls up to join him on the dance floor. Their friend Ben, the pale, slightly awkward one, seems a little better. He smiles brightly at her, attempting to make conversation. Where's she from? Where's she been? How long has she been travelling? Before she can answer his questions, Darren crashes between them, spilling her red wine down the front of her top. He lets out a hyena howl of a laugh, then disappears again. It's the last straw. She snatches up her bag and storms off. It's time to go home. Halfway across the room, she realizes just how drunk she is, the evening's excesses sloshing queasily around her empty stomach. She changes direction, deciding to pause for a cigarette to steady herself, and heads instead towards the set of double doors that lead out onto the balcony at the front of the pub. Once outside, she pushes her way through the crowd until at last she reaches the railing. The first rush of nicotine sets her head spinning. For a moment, she feels like she might throw up. It passes, though, and by the time she's halfway through the roll-up, she feels a little more together. She turns away from the crowd and looks out over the edge of the balcony. Below her, a sea of people spills out of the beer garden and laps onto the streets. Most of them are around her age, a mix of locals and backpackers, everyone talking, laughing, shouting, drinking, having a good time. Beyond them, the street lights pick out a row of palm trees that line the far side of the road. The sight of them immediately lifts her spirits. She remembers she's on the other side of the world, as far away from home as she can get without going back on herself. And sure, it might have been a rubbish night, but there will be other, better nights just around the corner. A million of them. There always are. A tram shambles past, momentarily drowning out the revelers in the beer garden below. She takes another drag on her cigarette, sending a plume of smoke drifting into the night sky. Past the palm trees lies the ocean, Port Phillip Bay, and after that, the Bass Strait. Not that she can see any of that from here. It's a new moon tonight, and there is only a deep darkness where the land stops and the water begins. She keeps looking all the same, leaning further out over the balcony as she tries to catch a glimpse of the distant waves, when she suddenly senses someone standing close behind her. She spins around to find Ben smiling at her. He holds up a hand, gives a shy wave. "Hey." To her surprise, she realizes that he's actually quite handsome. Huge green eyes, thick brown hair, the faintest flicker of a moustache tracing his upper lip. There's a sweetness that radiates from him, something soft and puppyish, which seems at odds with the oafish company he's keeping. He points to the dark stain on the front of her dress. "Sorry about Paul. I was going to say he's just had too much to drink, but on second thoughts, he's always like that, even sober. They both are." He laughs, and again, Sophie is struck by how sweet he seems. "So what are you doing with them if you don't like them?" He wrinkles his nose. "I mean, they're harmless, really. It's all just an act. You wouldn't know it by looking at him, but Paul's basically a millionaire, or at least his dad is. He runs some big wholesale business back at home. When he first came to school, he actually got bullied for his posh accent. He just puts on the tough guy thing because he thinks it impresses people, or rather, he thinks it impresses girls." Sophie rolls her eyes. "I'm obviously immune to his charms." "I suspect you're not the only one." They both laugh. "Anyway, what about you?" Ben asks. "What are you doing with those two?"
"Who? Max and Samantha?"
She crosses her arms. "Why? What's wrong with them?"
"Oh, nothing. It's just you don't seem anything like them. You're so..."
Before he can finish, a scream rings out above the clamour of the crowd. The door to the balcony creaks open, and a snatch of argument reaches them. One of the voices is disturbingly familiar.
"Take your hands off me!"
It's Mags. In a single movement, Sophie stubs out her cigarette and rushes away, leaving a confused Ben trailing in her wake. Inside the pub, a scrum of onlookers has already formed. Sophie barges her way to the centre, where she finds Mags remonstrating with a pair of squat-necked bouncers.
"What's going on?"
Sophie demands. Mags spins around. As she does, it's painfully obvious just how drunk she is. Her lipstick smeared, her eyeliner running in inky streaks down her face. She's a mess.
"I can't find my bag," she slurs. "And when I told these fuckers,"
she spits the word at the bouncers,
"they said I'm too drunk and that I have to leave. But the pair of them can..."
Before she can finish, she hunches forwards and vomits onto the floor, spraying Sophie in the process. The bouncers explode into barks of purple-faced fury.
Right, that's it. Get her out of here. Right now.
Sophie steps forward to steady her friend, but by now Mags's knees have gone from under her, her eyes rolling in her head as she slips from consciousness. But then, out of nowhere, Ben is there, skidding and slipping in the pool of sick as he scoops the drunk girl up into his arms and then half carries, half drags her towards the exit.
Don't worry, we're going,
he says to the bouncers, before turning back to Sophie.
Where are you staying?
She looks at him in surprise.
You're coming with us?
Well, you can't exactly carry her by yourself, can you?
2. Ben's not sure how they make it back. It takes more than an hour, with Mags insisting on stopping every few minutes to hurl either insults or the contents of her stomach, which, judging by the colour of it, contains at least 2 bottles of red wine alongside the countless Jaeger bombs, cocktails and tequilas she'd downed earlier on in the night. Somehow, between them, they eventually manage to steer, drag and cajole her back to her hostel. Once they arrive, Sophie tells Ben to wait for her outside while she attempts to wrestle her friend into bed. Just give me a minute, okay? I can go if it's easier. No, it's fine. I'll come back down and say goodbye properly once I've got her to sleep. It'll only take a minute. On cue, Mags gives an incoherent yell. They both turn to see her squaring up to the glass door at the entrance, apparently attempting to start a fight with her own reflection. Sophie rolls her eyes. On second thoughts, you'd better make that 2 minutes. Once they've gone, Ben shuffles around uncertainly. Although it's late, the streets churn with late-night drinkers. Some are finishing up for the night, while others are just getting started. A scream echoes in the distance, followed by the percussive fizz of a bottle smashing against brick. Someone begins to sing, loud and out of tune. You'll never walk alone. Ben's not quite sure what he's doing here. He worries it might seem a little presumptuous hanging around like this, that Sophie might think he's hitting on her. But then again, hadn't she been the one to ask him to wait? Or was he misreading the whole situation? He wishes he hadn't had so much to drink earlier. In his back pocket, his mobile phone begins to rumble, interrupting his thoughts. He tenses. He's only recently started carrying a phone, and even now he's still caught off guard every time it rings. He hates the idea of being reachable no matter where he is or what he's doing. Who wants that? Besides, he'd always felt they were faintly ridiculous things, strictly the preserve of stockbrokers and drug dealers and posers. And yet now the devices have gradually become so ubiquitous that he's finally been forced to relent, joining the hordes of hunched-neck sheep who sat on the bus playing Snake each morning, or blasting moronic polyphonic ringtones at full volume. Taking out his phone, he sees the name Nan illuminated on the screen of his little grey Nokia. He shakes his head. Though he's been gone for less than a week, she's called him every single day, despite his countless attempts to explain the astronomical roaming charges he faces whenever he picks up the phone to her. Nor can she seem to figure out the time difference between the UK and Australia, forever ringing at the most inopportune moment, usually during the early hours when he's way too drunk to speak to her. He's used to these misunderstandings, of course. They're just one of the many hazards of being raised by an older relative. He hadn't known either of his parents. His father had disappeared before he was born, and his mother, a troubled teenager with addictions to both hard drugs and horrible men, not long after that. While he loved his nan to bits and was forever grateful that she had taken him in and brought him up, he still envied his friends' parents, many of whom seemed to be practically the same generation as them. Whereas his nan had always struggled to grasp the simplest things, like when she bought him the latest PlayStation game for his birthday. Great, only he didn't have a PlayStation. Or the time she booked them a weekend break at Butlin's, only for them to arrive not only on the wrong day, but also at the wrong Butlin's. Still, as infuriating as she could be, he knew everything she did came from a place of love. More importantly, she'd always been there for him, which is more than he could say for his real parents. His thumb hovers over the answer button. You're still here? Ben looks up to find Sophie standing in the doorway. He takes one last glance at the screen, then declines the call. Sorry, Nan. He'll speak to her another time. I'm still here, he smiles. She's changed outfits, swapping her sick stained dress for a pair of denim shorts and a red top. You look nice. Sophie flushes, tugging her shorts a little lower. I look terrible, but it's all I've got. Backpacker's wardrobe, I'm afraid. It's either this or an elephant print sarong. Well, you're definitely beating me on the not being splattered with sick front. She grimaces. Sorry again about my terrible friend. Don't be. I'm sorry for my terrible friends too. I guess that's something we have in common. She raises an imaginary drink. To terrible friends. To terrible friends. So who was that? She asks, nodding to the Nokia. Hang on. Don't tell me. It's your wife, right? You were due home hours ago and she's sending out a search party? Wives, he corrects her. Didn't I mention I'm a polygamist? My hostel's basically a harem. As if on cue, his phone lets out another frantic rattle. He kills the call again. Are you sure you don't need to take that? He shakes his head. It's fine. Anyway, how's the patient? Mags? Oh, you know, 1 minute she's trying to headbutt me, the next she's snoring. So, more or less back to normal, I'd say. They both laugh again, before an awkward silence settles over them. Ben's about to suggest they swap numbers, when Sophie speaks up instead. Look, do you want to go somewhere? I'd invite you in, but they're mega strict about guests here. Sure, he says, a little too eagerly, before remembering his ruined clothes. I mean, I'm not sure I'll get in anywhere. I don't know if you've noticed, but I stink of vomit. Oh, shut up. It's Friday night. Everyone stinks of vomit. It's an Australian tradition. Practically de rigueur. Anyway, we don't have to go anywhere. We can just walk. I'm not tired, and I can't face going back into that room again just yet. Ben's phone buzzes one last time. He kills the call again, before stuffing the infernal device back into his pocket. Not now, Nan. Okay, sure, he smiles. Let's walk.
3. Is it her idea to head to the beach or his? Or perhaps it isn't a conscious decision at all, and the two of them are simply drawn by the same invisible force that steers every trickle towards a tributary, every river to the sea. Either way, an hour or so later they wash up opposite the espy, having more or less walked in a huge circle, stopping only for a slice of pizza along the way. They take a seat beside each other on a small stone wall next to the pier, their feet dangling over the water. Behind them, the old hotel is closing up for the night, their bands having finally fallen silent, the last few stragglers finishing up their beers and staggering off towards the dying embers of Fitzroy Street. Since leaving the hotel, they have talked in fits and starts, cautiously mapping out common ground between them. Along the meandering course of their conversation, it's transpired that they're both due to start university in London in September, Sophie to study drama and theatre arts at Goldsmiths, while Ben is taking law at Greenwich. I can't believe we're both going to be living south of the river. We're practically going to be neighbours. We can hang out all the time, have parties. It's going to be epic. Ben laughs. Hey, slow down. We don't even know each other yet. You might turn out to hate me. Or you might turn out to be a serial killer. Exactly. Which would explain why you want to study law, so you know, you don't get caught. Or if you do, so that you can defend yourself with legal loopholes. Bah, I can't believe you've seen through my evil master plan. Consider yourself foiled. They both laugh. But seriously, I think it's cool you're studying law. I can totally picture you as a hotshot lawyer. Maybe. Although if I'm honest, sometimes I don't know why I'm even taking it. I've got no real idea what I want to do once I finish. I've always been insanely jealous of those people who seem to have their whole lives planned from the age of 5. What about you? I bet you've always wanted to be an actress, haven't you? Sophie shrugs. Well, I'm an excellent liar, which is basically the same as acting, right?
Besides, I figure drama's easier than a proper course, like maths or particle physics, or law for that matter.
So you're looking for an easy ride?
Always. They laugh again. Sophie rolls another cigarette and changes the subject, pointing out at the ocean. I was in Halong Bay in Vietnam a few months ago, and I saw the most amazing thing. They had these plankton there that glow when they're disturbed. Bioluminescence, it's called. Our guide turned the lights off on the boat and then sailed through a patch. It looked like the sea was on fire or something. It was mind-blowing.
That sounds incredible, he says. I'd love to see it.
Well, what's stopping you? You can fly from here. Ben shakes his head.
I don't think I've got time. I'm on a pretty tight schedule.
How long are you here for?
4 weeks. It was supposed to be a gap year at first. Then that became a gap month when I realized how little my local supermarket paid.
The checkouts?
Shelf stacker. Quick save. $4.25 an hour.
Nice.
Worth it for this holiday, though. I've never been abroad before. Never even been on a plane until last week. I've never been anywhere, unless you count Western Supermare.
Where?
Exactly. That's why I was so determined to make the most of it here. I might only have a month, but I planned it all out. Bungee jumping and jet skiing, champagne sunsets at Uluru, and boat trips at the Great Barrier Reef. But the only thing we've done so far is...
drink? Ben shrugs.
I guess I'm just scared I'm going to run out of time.
Neither of them says anything for a moment. Only the sound of Ben's phone vibrating in his pocket breaks the silence. He waits for it to stop. Take a hint, Nan. Out on the water, a faint yellow light flashes intermittently. Sophie thinks about the night fishing trip they went on in the Philippines, clinging to a wooden catamaran while their guide attempted to lure sardines with a kerosene torch.
You know, I don't think it matters how long you've got here, she says.
I mean, it's quality, not quantity, right?
If it was a choice of either having 10 mediocre years or a single life-changing, mind-blowing evening, I know which one I'd choose.
10 years.
Funny.
Okay, fine. So if we wanted to transform this night from 6 splashed mediocrity into something truly mind-blowing, what would you suggest?
She thinks for a moment.
I mean, we could go and see the penguins.
He stares at her, perplexed.
Penguins?
Are you kidding me? How do you not know about them? They're practically world famous. There's like 1,000 miniature penguins nesting on the rocks by the pier. Come on, I'll show you. They're just over here.
With that, she hops off the wall and begins to jog away towards the sea.
Hey, where are you going? He calls after her. You want to look for penguins now? It's 3 in the morning.
But Sophie has already disappeared into the darkness.
4. As he follows her down the pier, Ben feels as if he is stepping off the edge of the world. Overhead, a row of lights illuminates the wooden slats beneath him, leaving an impenetrable blackness either side. Only the steady hiss and smack of the waves indicate there's anything out there at all. He keeps walking, passing a small wooden kiosk as he steps further and further out to sea. After a while, he pauses to look back at the city. From here, it looks like a string of fairy lights glinting in the distance. When he turns again, he finds Sophie waiting for him up ahead. So where are these penguins then? He asks. They normally nest here, but you have to look really hard. They're tiny. She leads him to the side of the pier, where he squints to see a rocky breakwater sloping away from them. They stand for a while, scanning the shadows, the steady murmur of the sea the only sound. Minutes pass, then more minutes. Ben turns to her. There aren't any penguins, are there?
Shut up. There are, I swear.
Uh-huh. Because if I didn't know better, I'd say this was all an elaborate ploy to get me out here so you could murder me.
Wait, what? I thought you were the serial killer.
Call it a plot twist. What if you're the deranged killer instead? Way more interesting, trust me.
And trust me when I say there are penguins here. Thousands of them, usually. I saw them a few days ago. There was a huge crowd of people watching them.
Ben looks up and down the empty pier.
A huge crowd? Yes. Actually, thinking about it, I was here a bit earlier last time, just after sunset. Maybe they've all gone to... roost? Do penguins roost?
No idea. You're the expert on the lesser-spotted Australian penguin. She laughs, then climbs up onto the railing, retrieving her tobacco and papers from her bag. He takes a seat beside her while she rolls up, her lighter sparking briefly in the darkness. They sit in silence again, smoke drifting out across the black nothingness beyond the rocks. After a while, Ben becomes conscious of the proximity of her legs to his, her bare thigh brushing gently against his leg each time she repositions herself on the railing. He realises he'd quite like to kiss her. He pictures himself leaning closer, pretending to brush a strand of hair from her eye or a stray eyelash from her cheek, just like in the movies. He's fairly confident she'd kiss him back. Wasn't that, after all, the real subtext of this daft penguin expedition? Or was he getting everything wrong? He curses his lack of experience. The last thing he wants to do is come across as some kind of sex-crazed sleaze. He's seen the way Darren, and particularly Paul, act around women, and it turns his stomach. And so he slides a little further away from Sophie, attempting to give her some space and make conversation instead. So what's out there then? He points out vaguely into the darkness. New Zealand?
No, silly. New Zealand's over there, practically behind you. There's not much out there at all, really. A couple of islands. The New Year group, I think. And then Tasmania beyond that. But assuming you miss those, well, I guess there's nothing for about 3,000 miles. Unless you slam straight into Antarctica.
So too far to swim? Unless you're a really good swimmer. More silence, during which she becomes aware of the heat radiating from her body. Again, the urge to kiss her is almost overwhelming. He swallows hard, bites his lip, digs his nails into the palms of his hands. Keep talking, he tells himself. Just keep talking.
You know, I've got to tell you something. Something I haven't told anyone before.
She turns to him then, wide-eyed, a trail of smoke ghosting from the corner of her mouth.
Well?
I actually hate the sea. She chuckles.
Who the hell hates the sea?
I mean, it's just so huge, like overwhelmingly vast. So are mountains and sunsets and the night sky. Do you hate all those too? Or do you reserve your hatred strictly for bodies of water? How do you feel about lakes, paddling pools, puddles? Shut up. I've not got anything against water, per se. Give me a proper, safe, chlorinated swimming pool and I'll stay in there all day. It's just the sea's got things in it.
Like?
Like insane murderous stuff. Before I came on holiday, I was reading about all the deadly creatures over here, which, it turns out, is most of them. But the sea is particularly bad. Did you know there's a jellyfish that's less than an inch long that's 100 times deadlier than a cobra?
An inch?
And then, at the other side of the scale, there's one whose tentacles are over 100 feet long. What's that? 3 buses? And let's not even talk about sharks.
Sophie is crying with laughter now.
I'm amazed you made it over here at all. You know, you didn't strike me as the panicky type.
Have you even been listening to me? I think panic is a perfectly reasonable response to a swarm of gelatinous death machines.
Okay, fair point. But you don't need to worry about that stuff here. All the killer jellyfish are up north in Darwin, which is about 2,000 miles from here. That's like being in Manchester and worrying about something in Moscow trying to kill you.
Like nuclear missiles.
You know what I mean. You're more likely to be killed in a car accident than by something out there.
I'm not convinced.
Well, let's find out, shall we?
Sophie finishes her cigarette, stubbing the butt in a shower of orange sparks, then abruptly hops down off the railing.
Ben watches as she walks over to the opposite side of the pier. What are you doing? She doesn't answer. Instead, she peels off her top, kicks off her sandals and climbs up over the railing. She stands there on the edge for a moment in her shorts and bra, looking out over the black water. Ben's heart is in his chest. Don't do anything stupid.
Like what?
I mean it, Sophie. I've told you it's perfectly safe. Look. With one hand holding onto the bar, she leans out backwards over the water. Seriously, don't. You don't know how deep it is. There could be rocks, anything. But Sophie winks at him. And then she lets go.
5. She hits the water awkwardly, a sharp slap sucking the air from her chest as she tumbles down into the darkness. For a moment she's disorientated, a violent roar in her ears as she sinks deeper, too stunned to swim. And then, quite abruptly, she breaks the surface, choking and spluttering. She treads water, catching her breath, while somewhere high above her a worried voice rings out. Jesus, are you okay? For a second I didn't think you were going to come back up. She forces a laugh. I'm fine. You should come in. Honestly, the water's beautiful. Yeah, thanks, but no thanks. I've seen Jaws enough times to know what happens right after somebody says that. Oh, come on. I swear there's nothing to worry about. Yet, even as she says it, she feels something slide past her toes. Seaweed? Or something else? Suddenly, she desperately wants to get out. What the hell is she even doing here? She'd been so desperate to impress this boy with all her fearlessness that she'd forgotten that she's not fearless at all. She's sensible, cautious, careful. And yet here she is, half drunk and shivering in the middle of the ocean. Overhead, Ben calls to her again. Are we going to get out? Oh, stop worrying, will you? But she doesn't know how she's going to get out. From here, the shore is a distant twinkle. Meanwhile, the walkway looms above her, high and unreachable. Eventually, she spots a stagger of steel steps jutting out from the pier, 100 meters or so away. She sets off towards them. Yet almost at once, she finds herself struggling. The current is stronger than she's expected, and for every stroke she takes, she is knocked back too by the swell of the waves. She finds herself thinking about stories she's heard of dangerous riptides, violent currents that can drag a person out to sea in a matter of seconds. She takes a deep breath, forces herself to keep calm. For a moment, she considers shouting for Ben to throw her down one of the lifebuoys attached to the side of the pier. Of course, she'd die of embarrassment. But it's better than drowning. When she squints up at the pier again, however, there's no sign of him. He's gone. She's on her own. Moments later, another big wave rolls into her, knocking her under again. She gasps, chokes. When she comes up, the steps are further away than ever. Another wave smacks into her, spinning her around. She can't see the steps anymore. She's not even sure which direction she's facing. Panic takes over. She thrashes, splashes, swallows salt water as she tries to hurl herself forwards, her energy sapping with every futile kick. By now, her head is spinning. She tries to call out for help. Help! To hell with the shame of it. But her voice is nothing but a hoarse rasp as wave after wave slams into her. And then she is slipping under. Sinking. Until suddenly, she slams into something cold and hard. Somehow, she's not been washed out to sea, but into the platform. She grapples around, trying to find a way to pull herself out. And then Ben is there, reaching down to take her hand and haul her up and out of the water. Are you okay? She nods. I'm sorry, it was rougher than I thought. You scared the life out of me. I know. I scared myself. She pauses. Still, it almost worked, didn't it?
What almost worked?
I almost got you in the sea. I reckon one more minute and you'd have been diving in to rescue me.
He shakes his head, laughing. You're insane. She follows him back up the stairs to the pier. As they reach the top, she begins to feel self-conscious, acutely aware of her near nakedness. She scrambles for her clothes. As she does, he reaches out for her, catching her lightly by the arm and spinning her around. Is this yours? He holds out one of her sandals. She reaches for it, her hand brushing against his as she does. And maybe it's the adrenaline from her near-death experience, or maybe it's the last of the cocktails working their way through her system. But somehow the distance between them shrinks to almost nothing, their noses almost touching, their breath becoming one. She smiles, tilts her head, closes her eyes. And then, somewhere nearby, she hears a buzzing sound, his phone ringing again. The moment is gone. He steps back, cursing. Impeccable timing, as ever, he says as he fumbles to stop it. Almost immediately, the phone starts ringing again. With a sigh, he brings it up to his ear. Hey, Nan, now isn't... He stops, listens. She watches as his face freezes. Immediately, she knows that something is very, very wrong. She stands there shivering as snatches of dislocated conversation drift across to her. How long? Who said? Why didn't? Until eventually he hangs up. He stands there for a moment. The phone hangs limp in his hand. Is everything okay? He looks stunned, the blood drained from his face. Is your Nan all right? He stares at her, his mouth opening and closing, his eyes shimmering. It wasn't Nan. It was my uncle. She's had a, I don't know, a funny turn, he called it. He found her collapsed. Oh, fuck. That's horrible. Is she going to be okay? He looks at her then, really looks at her. And when he does, she sees the terror in his eyes. No. Not really, she's... He can't finish. He doesn't need to. 2070. 2. It's Sophie's second visit to the hospital. An entire 9 hours have passed since she was last here, during which time she went home and then comprehensively failed to shower, eat, or sleep. Instead, all she did was sit there, counting the minutes until she could return to Ben's side, frantic with worry that something would happen to him in her absence. As she makes her way to the intensive care unit now, she bumps into the pretty young doctor with the striking green eyes, who explains that none of the tests have revealed anything useful. Brain activity, heart function, bloods, everything looks normal. Although the change in hair colour is odd. Anecdotally, a rapid loss of pigmentation is sometimes associated with chronic stress, although it's not something I've personally come across before, especially so quickly. If I had to take a stab, I'd assume it was some kind of autoimmune response, a rare virus, maybe, or exposure to chemicals or strong medication. Do you know if Ben was undergoing any kind of treatment before he collapsed? Treatment? Sophie hesitates, unsure.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.